House Speaker Romuald is also weighing in on the renewed push for charter change. He says aside from economic gains, amending the 1987 Constitution will help the Philippines protect its sovereignty. Without giving details, Romualdez says the country should exhaust all means to enforce its territorial rights as it faces China's aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
Malawak din ang scope ng hindi lang amendments but revisions to the Constitution at dun sa sinasabi mong how to enforce our territorial rights, we shall exhaust and utilize all within the legal framework of our countries. We will explore all means not only to open up the constitution to further encourage more foreign direct investments para makakaroon ng mas maraming trabaho at livelihood sa ating bansa, giving better lives and livelihood to all Filipinos, but we shall also further the ends of our interests internationally by enforcing our territorial integrity. No?
House of Representatives is pushing for charter change next year as lawmakers move to lift what they describe as restrictive economic provisions. Philippine senators, though, are not keen on discussing such proposals. Turning now to the 2024 national budget, House Speaker Martin Romualdez says the spending plan is pro-poor with nearly 500 billion pesos allotted to help low-income families. He adds millions of Filipino households will receive a one-time cash assistance worth 5,000 pesos. The House Speaker also believes the 2024 budget will reflect the priorities of the Marcos administration.
Itong taon na to na 2024 national budget, itong pinakamalaking budget ay isa sa tambi natin para sa ating pro-poor na projects. Education is the number one priority sa ating national budget. So, dati mga programa na libreng edukasyon hanggang hindi lang secondary, tertiary level ay tuloy-tuloy pa rin. At priority talaga ang edukasyon. At itong sa pambahay, dito ay kasama din to sa mga legacy projects ng ating mahal na Pangulo. Meron din tayong legacy ng specialty hospitals kagaya ng mga hospital na kagaya ng PGH, National Kidney Center, Heart Center. Tungkol pa rin yung legacy sa food security.
President Marcos is expected to sign a 5.7 trillion peso national budget today, Wednesday. Senator Francis Tolentino says he will step down in January as chairperson of the Philippine Senate's Blue Ribbon Committee. Tolentino says he will honor a deal he made with the Senate leadership to head the Blue Ribbon Committee for only a year and a half. The senator also admits his 2025 re-election plans are also part of the reason for his move. It's still not clear who will replace him.
It is my intention to honor an agreement in fulfillment of a sacred commitment to serve as Blue Ribbon Committee Chairman and member of the Commission on Appointments for a concise term of 1.5 years. I find it both a duty and an honor to uphold the essence of a prior agreement. This decision is rooted in a deep-seated belief that public office demands fidelity to pledges made.
China once again accusing the Philippines of deliberately stirring tensions in the West Philippine Sea. See, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. told Japanese media Manila's diplomatic relations with Beijing are headed in a poor direction following a series of tense encounters at sea. But for China, the Philippines is the one to blame for the deterioration of the ties between the two countries.
The responsibility lies with the Philippine side. China firmly safeguards its territorial sovereignty and maritime rights and interests. At the same time, we believe that maritime differences are not the entirety of China-Philippine relations. China is willing to properly manage differences through dialogue and consultation with the Philippines and will not close the door to dialogue and contact with the Philippines.
China earlier warned the Philippines tying itself to major powers in their maritime dispute will lead nowhere. Aside from sharp comments on the state of ties between Manila and Beijing, President Marcos also said the Philippines is looking for a different approach in dealing with China's aggression. As this report tells us, the president admits traditional diplomacy has been of no help at all.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. is eyeing a new strategy in Manila's approach in its maritime row with China. In an interview with Japanese media, Marcos said the traditional methods of diplomacy, that includes sending a note verbal to Beijing whenever there's a maritime incident in the West Philippine Sea, has seen very little progress. Marcos believes the Philippine government must do something it has not done before and come up with a new concept or idea or a paradigm shift in addressing Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea. The president's mention of a paradigm shift followed the announcement of NSC Deputy Director General Jonathan Malaya that they formulated a new strategy to deal with China in the West Philippine Sea. But this is still up for approval of the president. In an interview with Teleradio Servicio, House Speaker Martin Romualdez said lawmakers are bent on fortifying the country's facilities in the West Philippine Sea to assert territorial integrity.
Napaka-immediate threat ay nakikita na nga natin sa West Philippine Sea. Na talagang protektahan ang ating sinasabing territorial integrity, yung yan ang sovereignty po ng ating Pilipinas. Lahat po kami ay nanumpa sa ating kaumbayan that we shall protect the sovereignty, the national territorial integrity of the Philippines. Kaya dito po sa nakikita ng threats, no? Initially yung CIA, doon natin na lang linagay at nagdagdag po kami. Pinapatibay natin at pinapalaki natin ang infrastructure natin dyan sa Pag-asa Island, yung sinasabing yung facility para sa mga barko, hindi lang sa para sa Philippine Navy o sa Coast Guard, pero sa lahat mga isla.
President Marcos also said the Philippines will continue talking to its partners in the Indo-Pacific region and to the rest of the world if necessary, to de-escalate the tension in the West Philippine Sea. Last month, the Philippines conducted joint patrols in the U.S. and Australia in an attempt to counter Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
President Marcos poised to revive a task force that would focus on the country's preparedness against the effects of El Nino. That's according to Defense Secretary Gilberto Teodoro, one of the two chairpersons of the El Nino panel. He says government is looking to fast-track permits for water projects and other infrastructure programs. The dry spell, which is expected to start this December and last until mid-2024, is seen to affect nearly all provinces in the Philippines. Let's now get an update on the weather from Pag-asa forecaster Anna Clauden.
Good morning. Here's the update to the low pressure area. It was estimated at around 185 kilometers south of Puerto Princesa City, Palawan, and this LPA is expected to exit our area of responsibility within the day. While the trough of this LPA and the shear line will bring cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over the Zamboanga Peninsula, Bangsamoro, Western Visayas, Mimaropa, Calabarzon, Bicol Region, and Aurora. While the northeast monsoon will continue to bring cloudy skies with rains over Cagayan Valley and Cordillera Administrative Region. Here in Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting a generally fair weather condition aside from isolated rain showers mostly in the afternoon or in the evening. The temperature range here in Metro Manila is from 25 to 31 degrees Celsius. In Baguio City is 16 to 24 degrees. And in Tagaytay is from 22 to 29 degrees Celsius. And that's the latest from Pag-asa. This is Anna Clauden. Good morning.
Thank you for that update, Anna. Filipino students win big at the World Robot Games in Taiwan. They hope their victory will put the spotlight on the transformative power of robotics. Izzy Lee has more.
The robotics elite team of DLSC and DLSAU celebrated their exceptional performance in the World Robot Games held in Taipei, Taiwan last month. The team secured an impressive haul of 65 medals, 3 trophies, and championship titles, outshining competitors from 5 countries. The team is being trained by coaches in coding, robot construction, and manipulation.
First, they were chosen from the robotics camp, and then they train yearly for every competition. So we prepare for each of the competition like months before the competition will be held. And the robotics coaches, they spend even Saturdays, Sundays, even the nighttime just to train the students.
A standout in the innovative category was the Dream House inspired by natural disasters in the Philippines.
And we aim to create a solution that addresses the sustainable development goals.
Ito pong flooding. Lalagay po siya ng water sa loob po ng mismong Dream House.
Pagkatapos po ng flood, may mag-i-inflate po sa ilalim po ng bahay para umangat po siya. Tapos mag-i-detach po siya sa kanyang sa lupa.
The Dream House, equipped to measure energy and simulate natural disasters, showcased innovative solutions, including an inflatable mechanism from flooding scenarios and seismic detection. Another remarkable entry in the innovative category was the Super Community.
We built this community so that people will use more renewable sources of energy and we can minimize the effects of climate change and protect our environment.
There's also this robot, which competed in the one-minute game category.
Basically, the point of this game is to pull the cans as much as we can during a one-minute time span of 1 minute, and whoever moves as much cans during that 1 minute will win the game.
In the Sumo Bot 1K category, a robot was introduced strategically equipped with sensors to outmaneuver opponents within the ring.
This is called the scooper. This is what's used to push out your opponent's robot. Then we also have distance sensors, so our robot is able to see the opponents from the front and the sides. We also have the brain.
But beyond the medals and trophies, the school underscores the commitment to preparing students for future career goals.
This is part of the 21st century skills that will be used by our students. It's not only for education purposes, but also for their life goals. If ever they would like to enter engineering courses or any coding courses, then they are already starting at a younger age, as early as grade school.
Easily, ABS-CBN News.